Welcome to Herbally Yours, an adventure into the world of natural medicine. Here is your host, Dr. Ellen Kamai, the natural nurse who will help you take the leap to ultimate wellness.
And greetings. Thank you so much for joining me, Ellen Kamai, the natural nurse, for another edition of Herbally Yours, right here on the voice of Nassau Community College 90.3 WHPC. Herbally Yours brings you the latest information about the many facets in the world of natural living. Today, we are happy to have as our guest Dr. Judith Orloff, who is a medical doctor. And in addition, she is the New York Times best-selling author of Emotional Freedom and is on the UCLA Psychiatric Clinical Faculty. She synthesizes the pearls of traditional medicine with cutting-edge knowledge of intuition and energy medicine, along with spirituality. Her new book that we'll be looking at today is called The Empath Survival Guide, Life Strategies for Sensitive People. It offers an invaluable resource to help empaths survive and, in fact, thrive in an often insensitive world. Also, she has a Facebook Empath Support Community, which already has more than 6,000 members, and you can join, too. Learn more at drjudithorloff.com. Thank you so much for joining us today, Dr. Orloff.
Oh, you're welcome. I'm happy to be on your show.
Let's go back in time a little bit and share with our listeners and me, what made you decide to become a medical doctor in the first place?
Well, it's interesting. That's kind of why I wrote the book, because I was an empath child, and I didn't know it, and so I suffered a lot. An empath is somebody who absorbs the energy of other people into their own bodies and can get exhausted by it, or get anxiety or depression. And when I was a little girl, I couldn't go into shopping malls and crowded places because I'd walk in fine and then walk out exhausted or with some ache or pain I didn't have before. And my mother, who was a physician, said, oh, no, dear, you just need to get a thicker skin, which is not something you say to an empath child. And so that was really my motivation for writing the Empath Survival Guide and also, you know, going into medicine, becoming an MD. I went through 14 years of medical training because I wanted to incorporate intuition and being an empath and energy medicine into conventional medicine, which is the gist of my practice, and to help sensitive people become empowered, you know, instead of thinking they're sissies or weak or, you know, feeling being unhealthy for so much of their lives. I wanted to write the book to give people strategies to use to protect and center themselves so they could be empowered by their gift of sensitivity.
I saw a movie once, I believe it was called The Doctors, and it actually followed a doctor who became a patient. And I think that really was an awakening experience, because it seems like so much in conventional medical training really is not geared towards sensitive people or sensitivity in general.
No, and there's a section in the book on empaths and health. And everyone who identifies as a sensitive person needs to really read this, because if you're an empath and you're sensitive, meaning you absorb energy or even symptoms from other people, and you go to a conventional doctor, they're going to put you on medication because they're not going to understand what you're feeling. They're going to pathologize you. And so I want everyone to know, if you're an empath, and there's a quiz in the beginning of the book to determine if you are one, but I think a lot of people listening already identify with taking on other people's stuff into their own body. You need to really learn the protection and centering techniques. And also, you know, I suggest going to an integrative doctor so they could have more of a context to understand being an empath, rather than thinking you're crazy or a hypochondriac or have a biochemical imbalance. So the first line of treatment for my empath patients is not medication. It's learning kind of behavioral intervention and spiritual techniques to center yourself.
Well, that's a really great for people to investigate. I know that it's interesting that you brought up when you walked into a mall or a place where there were a lot of people, that it was not comfortable for you. And I had a similar experience. And although I am not the least bit introverted, obviously, do radio all the time and lecture almost every day somewhere. But I found it was energetic in terms of electromagnetic fields, not so much output from other people's psyches.
Right. Empaths are what I call electrosensitive, and they're sensitive to electromagnetic radiation around computers, you know, around phone lines. And so you have to take special care, you know, in terms of protecting yourself from that. But sometimes empaths can be sensitive to that. And some of the research behind being an empath involves what the HeartMath has found, the HeartMath Institute, which has done such great research on this, that there's electromagnetic fields coming from the heart and the brain, and that conveys information. It can convey emotions. It can convey information about the person. And empaths, who are people who don't have the normal defenses or filters, can pick that up. And so an empath, just by virtue of being close to another person, can get transmissions from the electromagnetic spectrum going from one person's heart to yours. It's really fascinating.
Yeah, I love HeartMath's research. Well, in your book, I think it's really great for people who sort of are feeling lost, or like you said, as a physician, they might just be getting diagnosis of general depression or anxiety, when really that's not the best path for them to be diagnosed on, because then they're simply given pharmaceuticals without any support or understanding in terms of what's going on with them.
That's exactly right. And the first thing to do if you think you're an empath is take the self-assessment test in the beginning of the Empath Survival Guide, and you can self-diagnose this. This is not something that has to be diagnosed by a physician, because there's certain commonalities that all empaths have. For instance, have you been labeled as, quote, overly sensitive all your life, which is said usually as derogatory or a put-down? Do you prefer replenishing your energy alone versus in crowds, which is signature for an empath? You know, are you sensitive to noise, smells, or excessive talking? Because empaths have a very strong sense of smell and are often noise sensitive, as I am, or I can't sit through the previews in the movie theaters because they're too loud for me. It's literally painful to my body. And do you prefer taking your own car places so you can leave when you please? Because empaths often have a tendency to go on sensory overload with too much social stimulation. And so they may like going to parties, but only like going for an hour or two versus three or four or five, where they feel overstimulated. So an empath needs to give themselves permission, you know, to leave. And I tell all my friends that, you know, when I go to parties, if I do, so I don't really prefer going, but sometimes I do if they're people I love, that I'll stay for an hour or two. And if they want to drive with me, they have to be prepared to leave early. And it's important as an empath to be able to communicate your needs to your loved ones. You know, a lot of empaths don't, because they're filled with shame and they're filled with self-criticism and they think there's something wrong with them. And I wrote the Empath Survival Guide to say there is nothing wrong with you. You have a gift. You're not crazy. You're not, quote, overly sensitive. You just have to learn skills not to absorb the pain or distress of other people into your body. So then you could maximize the gifts, which are intuition, going deep with people. Empaths are deeply compassionate and caregivers and love to give and help the world. You know, they often go into the helping professions. There's a section in the book on being an empath therapist and how not to take on your patients' emotions and physical
symptoms. That is really helpful. And I want our listeners to know that you are listening to Herbally Yours on the Voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. I'm Ellen Kamai, the natural nurse, and my guest today is Dr. Judith Orloff, medical doctor and the author of the Empath's Survival Guide. It must be so supportive when a patient finds you, Dr. Orloff, or I imagine you're on a campaign to make this knowledge more accessible to other physicians, so that they can share this with their patients.
Yes, I can, and not just physicians. What's been so heartening to me on my book tour for the Empath Survival Guide is that therapists and psychologists are coming to my events with their patients. And that, to me, makes me so happy because, you know, it shows there's just a deep understanding of the therapist about being an empath, and they want to help their sensitive patients and, you know, be very, very supportive, and I love that. And yes, I'm on a campaign to educate medical doctors and people who are in conventional medicine so that they can have a deeper understanding for their sensitive patients. And, you know, one thing with empaths is they often need a lower dose of medications, whatever it might be, because they get bowled over by the elephant doses of drugs that are dispensed now. And so the physician treating an empath needs to know that. And especially some empaths who may need to go on antidepressants, it's a big may, often only need a sliver of the medication. They don't need the whole thing because it affects them. Their systems are so sensitive, it affects them. A smaller amount goes a long ways. And so that's part of the education of physicians that I'd like to, you know, really, you know, get across, you know, so that they can treat their sensitive patients adequately and compassionately.
And I would say, although some people that you are describing who are sensitive may need some help on a physical level with helping to balance neurotransmitters and other brain chemicals, it would be great to actually measure something like amino acid levels, B vitamin levels, magnesium levels, and also look at herbal components and use those first as a first line of defense, along with a deeper understanding of your sensitivity issues. And then, of course, if more advanced pharmaceuticals and more dangerous, of course, pharmaceuticals might be indicated, that would be a next step.
Right, absolutely. I'm all for that. But even on an herbal level, they need less herbs. So, you know, it's interesting because the key is if you're an empath and you're going to a healthcare professional, you have to listen to your body and you have to really tune in to how something feels in your body. If you take an herb or you get anything, you know, any kind of treatment, you have to ask yourself, how is this feeling in my body? And if any physician or anybody says, oh, you shouldn't be feeling that way, or you're the only one who's ever felt that way, which is the refrain of my life, you know, because I've had so many, quote, side effects or whatever that nobody has ever felt before, you know, that to me is, it doesn't matter if anyone else has ever felt it. It matters that I feel it. And so it's important that if you have a reaction to something, stand firm with your reaction. This is your feeling. This is your experience. And empaths often lose faith in themselves because they get this ridiculous argument that because everyone hasn't felt it, it doesn't exist. And I'm really against that. If you feel something and you come to me and say, I feel the world is purple, I'll believe you.
Well,
you work with that.
We're going to take just a little break here, Dr. Orloff, and like to remind you, you are listening to Herbally Yours on the Voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. Listen live or online at ncc.edu/WHPC. For more information on today's guest or topic, email whpc@ncc.edu. Stay tuned. Herbally Yours will be right back.
Peek-a-boo. Peek-a-boo. Smile.
Smile, buddy.
Come on. Smile. Oh, honey. He's still not smiling.
Maybe he's not a smiler.
Yeah. Maybe he's just not a happy baby.
Maybe he's just being a boy. You know how boys are.
Or maybe he's teething. Oh, poor baby. I think his gums hurt.
Maybe he's just tired.
Or maybe his tummy hurts. He didn't eat that much.
Maybe he's not ticklish.
You think maybe he's scared of the dog?
Maybe he'll outgrow it. Maybe it's a phase. Maybe he just doesn't like smiling.
Maybe he has autism, and we can definitely do something to help.
Maybe is all you need to find out more about autism. No Big Joyful Smiles by 6 months is one early sign. Learn the others at autismspeaks.org/signs or see a doctor today for an autism screening. The sooner it's diagnosed, the better. And it can make a lifetime of difference. Brought to you by Autism Speaks and the Ad Council.
And welcome back to